somebody that will get in the field and work at bringing in his harvest. He suffered on the cross, took all the punishment for all the sins of all humans. He became all their sicknesses, all their diseases, all their curses, all the ramifications on the cross. Suffered that in order that people could be brought into the heavenly kingdom. But he said, look, I see a white harvest, it's ready, but I can't find the workers. So he said, pray the Lord of the harvest, that's Jesus, pray the Lord that he will send forth laborers into the harvest. The word send forth in the Greek again is apostolize. That means that God gives them a special, and sends them in on a special mission with a special anointing, with a special something to get done. Okay. So he said, pray about that. So I just want to bring that up. Pray the Lord of the harvest. Now, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, reading this in Matthew, the title that the Bible translator put is the compassion of Jesus. The compassion of Jesus. And he said, then Jesus went about all the cities and villages. How many cities and villages? All the cities and villages. All of them. You want to know the heartbeat of Jesus Christ? Do you want to know Jesus? Do you want to feel his heart? He's interested in all the cities and all the villages. He's interested in all the people. And he wants his messengers to go to all of these places. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues. Where did he go first? He went first to synagogues. Synagogues. What is synagogues about? That's the equivalent of churches. That's the equivalent of the place where people are trying to be spiritual people, that are people that are trying to know God. Go to those people first and instruct them in the ways of God. First, that's where he went first. And he said he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom, preaching the good news of the kingdom. What's the good news of the kingdom? That this realm of Satan will end. And that Jesus as king will rule over all the earth. Preach the gospel of the kingdom. That this whole thing is coming to an end. Preach the gospel of the kingdom. That God is judging all this. Preach the gospel of the kingdom. That the king requires there to be repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to avoid his wrath and punishment. Preach the gospel of the kingdom. That all the kingdoms of this world will bow down. Preach the gospel of the kingdom, that all governors and kings, all presidents will be judged. There will be one King of Kings and one Lord of Lords. Preach the gospel of the kingdom, not something else. Preach the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. So Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom and he healed every kind of sickness and every kind of disease. Well, we don't preach the gospel of the kingdom, and we got more doctors now, more science, more medicine, more pills. They push pills on all the advertising today, yet people are sicker than ever. They're more diseased than ever. And I got news for you, it's going to get worse, it's not going to get better. So for so much of the intellect of man that knows a better way than God's way, you know, more people are taking antidepressants, more people are going to psychiatrists than ever before. They're drugging more kids than ever before, but yet we still are in our intellectual pride saying we know better than God. See, the problem with these people in most cases is the root is in sin. But they've never repented of it. You see, so it's still eating them up. So they try to take a pill for a cure. But it isn't going to cure it. Only Jesus has the cure. All right. But anyway, I don't want to get, that's not the message tonight, but and healing every sickness and every disease among the people, verse 36. When he saw the multitudes, now he's looking at all these massive mounds of people. Here, the heartbeat of God, the heartbeat of Jesus Christ. He's going out to where they are. He's preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He's healing them of every sickness. He's healing them of every disease. And he's looking on the multitudes, and the Bible says he was moved with compassion for them. Why? The Bible says, because they were weary. How about you? Are you weary? Are you tired? How many people out there are weary and tired? They work and they're weary and tired. They're trying to pay the bills and they're weary and they're tired. I dare say, go knock on doors in this neighborhood and everybody's going to tell you they're weary and they're tired. You know why? Because it's a devil system. It's not God's system. And it's coming to an end. And he looked on them and he was moved with compassion because they were weary and scattered. Scattered all over. How about you? Are you all scattered in your thoughts? Are you all scattered in your approach of life? Are you all scattered in all the things you got to do? My goodness, we need a shepherd. So he had compassion because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Like sheep having no shepherd. He had compassion for them. He was doing what he could. He was going to the cities. He was going to the villages. He was going to the place where the spiritual people gathered to try to show them the ways of his Father, try to show them the ways of the kingdom. And as he looked amongst all the people, he saw they're all tired out. And they were people that had no leader. They had no shepherd. They had nobody to lead the way, to guide the way. He said, pray that God would raise up people, apostolize them to go and lead them the way they should go. That's what he's saying. Look, he said, the fields are white to harvest. There's more harvest to get than anybody can get, but there's nobody to work in it. Pray that the Lord would raise up and send forth people to work in that harvest. They're weary. They have compassion. They're tired. They don't know where to go. They don't know what to do. They don't know the way. He needs shepherds to go out under him as the great shepherd to lead the people where they should go. Verse 37, then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. But the laborers are few. All kinds of harvest, ripe harvest. White on the harvest means it's at its ripest place. This is a time for the harvest. But there's only a few handfuls. Multitudes of people, multitudes of people, all needing a shepherd. His heart is for them, but only a few workers. Only a few workers. Verse 38, he said, therefore, because of that, pray that the Lord of the harvest to send out. That's the word apostle. Hello, apostolize. Send out is to mean sent forth. That's the word apostolize. Pray the Lord of the harvest that he send forth laborers into his harvest. It's his harvest. He died for the harvest. He died to get the harvest in before it's too late. That is the heartbeat of God. But he can't find enough workers because they're too busy with everything else. Lord, have mercy. That's the first part. Pray. Pray the Lord of the harvest to send forth labor. So from now on, I'm hoping that the Holy Spirit's going to bring that to your remembrance. This is the heartbeat of Jesus Christ. This is the heartbeat of God. You want to be in the center of God's will? Be in the center of the harvest. Be in the center of getting the laborers, being a laborer in the harvest, and getting laborers into the harvest. All right. Now, Jesus said this, Matthew 16, 18. He said, I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail. I will build my church. Kind of a little bit of the theme is along with the last Sunday that we met together. We had a little intermission for a little while. And the enemy liked to make it a permanent intermission, but it won't be. This goes a little bit along with the warfare. Let me write this on the board. Warfare. We're in a spiritual warfare. And it's equated to a wrestle. And against. Again, wrestle. Pele, the word for talks about in the last days, Satan is going to try to wear out the saints. What's it say about Jesus? He looked on them and they were, what? Weary, having no shepherd. We must know the shepherd, Jesus Christ, and follow him so that we can receive from him resurrection strength, resurrection life and strength. Okay, we must stay in Jesus. You cannot stay in Jesus unless you stay in obedience. Without obedience, you cannot stay in the life of Jesus. In him is life, and the life was the light of men. There was a law, the law of the Spirit. There was a law, the law of sin and death. If a man sinned, he died. But now there's a new law, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Now, when we're born again, we're born into Jesus, but we must remain and continue. If you remain and continue and abide in me, then you will bear much fruit, and in that my Father will be glorified. Now, we're going to get to about fruit. Fruit. How about you? You got any fruit grown on the tree that says you're of Christ? You have any fruit grown that says you're of Christ? So mercy escapes, huh? Anyway, going back to Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will build. First of all, Jesus said there is a building process. A building process. He is building. First of all, he is building. 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 There must be something being built. Okay? Our lives are to be built up in the things of God. Okay? If we're doing a work for God, then there has to be a building of something. Now, he said, in the gates of Hades will not prevail. Hades, again, is the Bible word for hell. Not the lake of fire. It's a holding place for dead sinners. A place of torment, a place of punishment, an abiding place after they physically die, waiting for the final judgment after the millennial reign of Jesus Christ, after the 1,000 years on the earth, where they go to the great white throne judgment. I bring it up all the time because we need to understand this. This has to be part of what we see in front of us, heaven and hell and the lake of fire, and we need to be aware of these things to motivate our life, to observe what manner of life we'll live. Okay. So there is a hell, and he says will not prevail. So this is telling us that there must be a fight. Hell, again, let's say Satan's headquarters. There is a headquarters of the devil. Satan has a system. Satan has an army. Satan has followers. Satan has workers. And so if Jesus said, I will build my church, there must be something in opposition to my church. If he said the gates or the power or the authorities, gate holds, lets in or holds out, the authorities of hell will not prevail. They will not overcome it. So there is a fight. There is a warfare. So there's two things here. The Church of Jesus Christ. There's two things for the Church of Jesus Christ. Number one is there's got to be something being built. Number two, there is a warfare. One or the other alone is no good. It's not going to happen. If all you're doing is having a warfare, you'll never build anything. You're never going to build the church or build the kingdom of God. If you think you're building the kingdom of God or building a church, but you never have any warfare, you're not building the church of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said, I'll build my church and the gates of hell will have no strength against it. There is a interference. There is a fight. There is a warfare. The true church of Jesus Christ has a warfare going on to stop it from being built. So anything of any value that we're going to do for God in this life, there has to be a building process and there has to be a warfare. There will, if you have no opposition, then you have to question yourself, Are you really building what God asked you to build? There has to be an opposition. This opposition, Jesus said, will take faith for the victory. And many people said, look at all this stuff to Jesus in the church in the book of Revelation. Look at all this beautiful stuff we have. We're rich. We got all this stuff. He said, no, no, no. You're blind. So we see, Jesus. He said, no, you're blind. He said, look at all we got. He said, you got nothing. He said, but I'm counseling you, buy from me gold refined in the fire. Refined in the fire. What's he talking about? Let me see your works that have been through the warfare, that you've built through the warfare, that is gold refined in the fires. In the fires of faith, in the fires. All right. Praise God. Now, thank you, brother. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So what is it? All of our work, Jesus said, would be tested. Excuse me, Apostle Paul, the Holy Spirit through him said, will be tested by fire in the end. All of this building that's going on in political correctness will be burned up in the fire. They're going to have nothing. I don't care how big it is. All of this stuff about building these big monstrosities, so-called under God, it's going to be burned up in the fire. It's going to be worthless. It's going to be nothing. Question is, where are these people who Christ has compassion on? Are we getting them in? Question, are we preaching to the same 50 people to get saved? Or are we reaching those who have never heard? Or are we reaching those who have never heard to be saved? Are we bringing them for the 50th or the 100th or the 200th or the 500th time the gospel message to the same stubborn few that won't get saved? Or are we going to those few hundred tribes that maybe are still in the earth that have not heard yet? Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world, and then the end. Amen. All right. So we have a job to do. We've got to finish. We have to finish the work. The days are evil. Many evil things are coming. We need to finish the work quickly. So we have to pray the Lord of the harvest to send forth laborers into the harvest. Amen? Pray the Lord of the harvest to send forth laborers in the harvest. We want those apostolized people by the Lord of the harvest. We don't want the ones that sent themselves. We don't want the ones that the seminary sent. God could have led them through a seminary, and that could have been God's direction for life. Fine. But we want to make sure we want them, those that the Lord of the harvest answers our prayers and sends forth, apostolizes laborers into his harvest. That's what we want. Those are the workers we want. We want true, bona fide disciples. Those that are ready. Those that are ready to build, and those that are ready to war, to fight. Ready to build and ready to build through a fight. We have a beautiful example of that in the Bible. His name is Nehemiah. Nehemiah, it says about Nehemiah, when God put in his heart to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, they went and they took an inventory and they saw it. Along came a guy named Sambalay, and he had his little boy Tobiah, and they began to threat him. Root of Sambalay, the root of the word Sambalay is Satan. God's telling us it was Satan that came, and Tobiah made false accusations to put fear in them so that they would not rebuild the walls of the city of God. Again, that's a beautiful picture. So Nehemiah's like us. We have to rebuild the walls of God's city, rebuild the walls of the Church of Jesus Christ. The Jews need to rebuild Jerusalem. They need to rebuild Israel because it's a time for the king to come. Okay? So there are walls to be rebuilt. And it says in him that he had to instruct his men, and they had in one hand they had a sword, and in the other hand they had a brick. Now, some guys from the inner city, they'll say, well, the brick was the fight too. But no, the brick was to build. They were rebuilding the walls, resetting the gates. And in the other hand, they had a sword because at any time the enemies could pounce upon them and they had to be ready to fight. And so that's a good picture. What Jesus was saying here, we have to be ready with a brick in our hand to build the church, which is the called out believers of God, teach them to observe everything he has commanded, make disciples of the ethnicities Jesus commanded us, which means we're building disciples. We're teaching them to observe what he said to do. We're teaching them the Bible so that they can do it. If they don't know it, if the thought never enters their head, they don't have a chance to do it. Now, when you give them the knowledge of God, it's they're responsible to change their thinking and their ways to do it. But we have to present it to them, and we have to keep encouraging them to do it, and we have to keep warning them to do it. That's how we're building. That's how we're building. And the enemy will try to stop that at every turn in every way. The enemy will try to stop that. So that's the warfare. And so we have to keep on going. We have to keep on doing until Jesus comes. Now, Luke chapter 12, verse 35. Jesus said this. He said, "Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning." You know, right before that, you know what he was saying to them? Sell what you have, give alms. Sell what you have, give alms. Give alms takes care of the real poor, those that have nothing. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old. He's saying this is the way to make sure your money doesn't fall out your pocket. Think of others less fortunate. Do something for others less fortunate. A treasure in the heavens that does not fall or does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So where's your treasure? According to Jesus, now he can't lie. He said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where's your treasure? He said, if you'll invest in the heavenly things, your heart's going to be there. Where's your heart? Lot's wife, she was all invested in Sodom and Gomorrah. She couldn't leave it. She's looking back when it was time to go out before the judgment. She had she was invested in Sodom and Gomorrah. Her treasure was in Sodom and Gomorrah. She turned to a pillar of salt. Sterility. Sterile. Salt is sterile. If you salt the ground, it will not produce. Part of what the Romans did when they judged Israel for the rebellion, they salted all the ground. That's when it became known as Palestine, by the way. And that was God's judgment on Israel, in part for many things, but in part for rejecting Jesus, missing the day of their visitation. But because they rebelled against God, again, in their history, and God allowed the Romans to overthrow them, fulfill the prophecy of Jesus, where every stone of the temple was taken, one upon another was taken down, thrown, all the gold and silver in the temple, all the gold inlaid, beautiful, it was one of the wonders of the world, it was all stripped out by the Romans. But God scattered them like he said he would in his prophets to all the nations. But God also said in the prophet that he would bring them all back, and he has. So this is the time of their restoration. But anyway, maybe Sunday we're going to talk more about the end times and about what's going to be happening in the Jewish people as further signs that we're at the end. But anyway, right now, have your waist girded and your lamps burning. And that's what he said here. He said, verse 25, right after he said, "For where your treasure is, your heart will be also. Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. And you yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they may open to him immediately. But let your waist be girded and your lamps burning." I want to give you that exhortation right now. Let your waist be girded. What is that a sign of, a symbol of? Serving. Say that, serving. who went away, but he's going to be coming back, he said, now you be busy serving. And he said, your waist girded and your lamps burning. Lamps burning, when do you need lamps to burn? At night. At the time of dark, your lamps got to be burning. So he's saying, not only work when it's day, he said, not only be working when it's day, but work day and night. Work day and night about being busy about this business. Now, I want to say some more things on there, but I'm going to jump to this other place for a minute, and then we'll come back there. Matthew chapter 25. You can hold your finger there because I'm going to bounce back there, I think. Matthew chapter 25. Let's take a look at how the Word tells us to look at this. Matthew chapter 25. Verse 5. Matthew 25, verse 5. It says, but while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slept and slumbered. While the bridegroom. All right, now. A minute ago, we talked about a wedding in Luke 12:35. We were talking about a wedding. And the master was getting ready to come, and he said, those were wise servants, their waist was girded, their lamps were burning. He's saying an attitude that needs to take place. Now here, he says, while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slept and slumbered. They slept and slumbered. They were asleep. They were sleeping. How about this? You could say they were not awake. Right? They were not awake. How about this? They were not alert. When the bridegroom was delayed, who's been delayed? Jesus has been delayed, but he's about to come. And we have to question, are we sleeping? Are we slumbering? So he said, the bridegroom was delayed, and they all slept, and they all slumbered. And at midnight, a cry was heard, behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. There were ten. Five were ready, five were not. Five were ready and five were not. And I know I've heard other people say, I hope Jesus wasn't prophesying, only half will be ready. They all were virgins, so they were all clean in the blood of Jesus. He said they all slept. I'm telling you what's happening in the body of Christ right now. Spirit of God is trying to wake up the body of Christ right now. The body has been asleep. And God is waking up the body. But according to this word, that it might be only half that wake up. One other thing about waking up. They all trim their lamps. And some tried to live off of just the oil they had. They tried to live off. But five others had extra oil in another vessel besides the oil that they had in their lamps. So I'm going to say to you, and people can get all theological all they want, but I'm going to say to you, this is a time to fill up with more of God. This is a time to get extra oil in your vessels. And in fact, you will not wake up appropriately without that oil. You must have the oil of the Holy Spirit to wake up. You must have the resurrection life of Jesus and the oil of the Spirit to wake up and be ready for this wedding to be caught up to be with God forever. All right. I'm just going to tell you just like it is. If anybody think and argue theologically till past when Jesus comes, I don't care. Now, trying to tell you some things that you need to do to be ready. Matthew chapter 25. Same chapter. Matthew chapter 25, verse 25. Matthew chapter 25, verse 25. The Bible says, here's a guy talking, answering. In his day of accountability and judgment, he said, I was afraid. produce five more. Two, you better produce two. One, you better not be afraid and hide it. You better put it to work, because he never rebuked this man for calling him a hard man. He never said, no, you were wrong. I'm not a hard man. You don't have to worry about it. Hey, at least you didn't lose it. No problem. Now, what did he say to this guy? He never rebuked him. This was a right revelation. This man was right. Yes, I'm coming back. You're right. Yes, I'm looking for a harvest on what I gave you. You're right. And you were afraid? That's a good thing to be afraid. And you know what? And I'm a hard man, and I'm looking for a return. So what did he say? Oh, Jesus. I was afraid, and I went and I hid your talent in the ground. Look, here, there, you have what is yours. He gave it back to him. Here's your one, you gave me one talent. Look, I didn't take a chance. I might not have used it right. I might have lost it. Here it is. Look, he said to Jesus, there you have what is yours. In verse 26, but the Lord answered, and the Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. You wicked and lazy servant. Wow. Here's his answer. You wicked and lazy servant. Now look. Did he say you wicked and lazy sinner? Did he say you wicked and lazy? What? He said servant. He's saying you're mine. I bought you. I gave you talent. But you hid it. And you're telling, because you're afraid. You know I was coming looking for a harvest, and you said you were afraid. And I say to you, you're wicked and lazy. He was afraid. But Jesus doesn't judge like we judge. He called them wicked and lazy. Still called them a servant, but a wicked and lazy servant. You see, Jesus is not looking for excellence. Hello, the world is. Jesus is not looking for excellence. The world system is. Jesus is looking for action, obedience. He never says he's looking for excellence. And when the Bible says, perfect, be perfect for he is perfect, be holy for he is holy, let us go on to the doctrine of perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works, of doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of resurrections of the dead, and of eternal judgment, and let us go on to perfection. If God permit perfection there, means completion. And you cannot go to completion